Cuba. Tonight, Jeffrey Brown visits the Havana Biennial Art Show to report on Cuba's booming art market, as well as the very real limits on free expression that remain in this socialist country. It's another installment in our series this week, The Cuban Evolution.
On a recent fine evening in Havana, one could follow the yellow brick road leading into the sea. Hopscotch through an American flag made of giant pickup sticks, enter a translucent cube, and look out at a blue world. All part of a grand festival, the Havana Biennial.
There's art all along Havana's famous Malecón and throughout the city right now. Art, in fact, is one of the ways this isolated island has chosen to show itself to the world, and the world is paying attention.
This is the city's 12th biennial, but it's the first since the U.S. and Cuba announced efforts to normalize diplomatic relations. Everywhere you looked, in various corners of the city, work by artists from some 42 countries, some of it fairly traditional, some of it not, like this tropical ice skating rink.
Why is the biennial so important here? What does it mean?
Margarita Sanchez is one of the biennial curators.
In Cuba, culture is very important. We live and work and express out our home in the street, maybe because of the weather, we don't know. Because we are Cubans, we are very expressive.
And increasingly very prominent on the international art scene. At the biennial, more than 250 Cuban artists exhibited works in the historic 16th century fortress on a bluff above Havana. Tony Rubenstein, an American with a new guidebook on Cuban contemporary art, says demand for this work is high.
The art market right now is exploding, especially on the very, very top end. There are artists here who are already in the Tate Modern, that are already in the Museum of Modern Art in New York, and when there is established here a museum of contemporary art, those artists, the value of their works will explode.
Hello, senor.
Howard Farber is one of the top collectors. At the biennial, he sponsored a gala affair to announce the first International Cuban Art Awards.
Our mission has been to spread the word on how great the art scene is in Cuba.
Farber began buying Cuban art in earnest and bulk in the last decade, after making millions on the sale of his contemporary Chinese art collection in 2007.
Is part of the attraction for you as a collector the forbidden?
I guess so. I never really thought about it before, but I like to collect and go where people haven't gone before.
It's a paradox in this home of the socialist revolution. Big money flowing from outside to artists inside.
This is the actual pulp, the original pulp of the paper.
Indeed, artists here are positively entrepreneurial. Adrian Fernandez and his partners were able to create this upscale studio after new laws made it possible to buy and sell property.
Well, thank you very much.
They now sell their work directly to consumers, mostly abroad, avoiding government-run galleries and reaping their own profits.
We deal directly with the people that reach us here, mm-hmm. that we connect directly.
Gracias. Welcome. Gracias. Good afternoon. Adrian, how are you?
And indeed, he and his friends were receiving American visitors by the busload during the biennial.
Ma'am, careful with the steps. Adrian, welcome.
So it looks three-dimensional.
In another part of town, an even more unexpected scene, the Beverly Hills Women's Club, talking money and monopoly art at the home of one of Cuba's most prominent artists.
I mix it all with a Coca-Cola sign.
Kadir Lopez takes old signs from American companies that were active here before the revolution and superimposes images and photographs on top of them.
I like to put some kind of metaphors in between.
It's a layering of times and messages, working through metaphor, he says, not overt politics, that can be read a variety of ways.
There are not too many left.
But what about the seeming contradiction of making art in a socialist country for Americans from Beverly Hills?
I put X amount of energy in a canvas or in a piece of metal on a sculpture or an installation. That energy could have a value market.
Yes, it does.
A person come and say, here is my energy, X amount of money that I'm willing to trade for you if you give me that. So That is how I balance that.
But isn't that capitalism?
Yeah, that could be capitalistic or no. I have no idea, and I don't think about it. I know that this is something good. It comes from my heart.
Call it what you will, clearly things are changing here. But some things remain, casting a shadow over the biennial.
I've been accused by the government to incite people to be delinquent, that I incite people to do public disturbances.
In the 2009 biennial, Tanya Bruguera presented a piece of performance art in which Cubans were invited to speak their minds. When she tried to stage it again in December, in response to the announcement of a reopening of diplomatic relations with the U.S., she was stopped and detained, her passport taken.
Were you trying to provoke a response?
Absolutely not. No. Absolutely not. I think I believed that it was a historical moment and that art has a role to play during historical moments. People were in shock. Why? Because it is an announcement that puts into reflection and to doubt and to rethink what it means to be Cuban, what it means to be revolutionary. I think it was a historical moment because it was a moment of identity crisis for the revolution.
She says fellow Cuban artists practice a form of self-censorship.
It's kind of sad when you have to conform with, you know, to just a little moment of complicity instead of being able to say, hey, this is what I think, and involve everybody else in that conversation.
Bruguera says she's been told she can leave Cuba, but only if she never returns, a deal she's refused. In the meantime, she awaits possible prosecution. The Havana Biennial minus Tanya Bruguera will be on display until June 22nd. From Cuba, I'm Jeffrey Brown for the PBS NewsHour.